Good morning. We're going to begin now. My name is Steve Levine. I'm a Schwartz Fellow here at the New America Foundation. Today, we're doing a future tense event called Arms Race versus Relay Race. Future tense, just to start out, future tense is a partnership between New America, Slate Magazine, and Arizona State University. It explores emerging technologies and how they may transform society and public policy. The China event that we're looking at today falls squarely against the backdrop of the financial crisis. When the financial crisis hit a few years ago, China came in very, very large and continued to be a juggernaut, but it also rose much more rapidly and much larger than many of us expected and larger than it expected. And fears rose around it. Was China going to come dominate the world? Was the West declining? More recently, we've heard about a new narrative, and that's that the latest pings of the financial crisis have struck China itself. Its growth has shrunk, and what we hear now is China may never come to dominate the world. It has too many structural flaws that it has to deal with, and so we may never see that. Through all of this, the fixed feature has been Chinese innovation. The question of whether China is going to become, as it has been, a manufacturing juggernaut, an innovation juggernaut. Is it going to become a bigger inventor and a predominant inventor in the world? And then the converse question, does it really matter whether that happens? Isn't incremental innovation, so-called process innovation, enough? Can't China continue to be a gigantic player and eventually a predominant player in the world just because it's ingenious at manufacturing, at tinkering in the lab? And then the final question, does it really matter? Can't we all just get along? So we're going to be exploring these questions today, and we have a fantastic group of panelists to look at that. Housekeeping matters. This event is being live streamed on the internet. Everything you say that you might say during the question and answer period will be live streamed, so everything here is on the record. Please switch off your cell phones, please. If you're on Twitter, you can join the conversation using the hashtag FT China for future tense China. So we're going to start out with a 10-minute presentation by one of our presenters today. His name is Yasheng Huang. Yasheng is a professor of political economy and international management at the Sloan School of Management at MIT. He wrote the book Capitalism and Chinese Characteristics, Entrepreneurship and the State. It was selected as a book of the year by The Economist in 2008. Yasheng founded MIT's China Lab, which helps entrepreneurs in China improve business management. Yasheng.
I just realized I'm the only person with a PowerPoint presentation, so I apologize for that. Thank you very much, Steve. My topic is on knowledge production. I'll be happy to have a discussion about the implications for the United States in the Q&A or in the panel discussion, but my own presentation is not going to be about that. And let me just point out that this is ongoing work I'm doing with my colleagues at MIT Sloan School, Fiona Morey and Kenny Ching. If you think about innovation and economic development as a sort of a supply chain, you know, at the top of the chain, there's the research, university research, and then patenting, right? Some of the research spills into patents, from there, commercialization, and then product development and marketing and all of that. My presentation is at the sort of the first tier of that process, university research. I won't say much about how much of that has been translated into products and patents. If we draw the experience from MIT, for example, my own institution, there's a study that shows that, that if you tabulate the sales, the value added of all the companies funded by MIT professors, alumni, students, including the companies in which MIT has made investments, as of 2008, the value added of all these companies is equivalent to the 11th largest economy in the world, right? Which is South Korea. South Korea is the 11th largest economy in the world. So university research, if you do it right, if you do it right, if it has complementary conditions, can have a huge impact on the economy in a way, for example, MIT has, and in a way probably Stanford has. I'm not sure China is there, but there are potentials for that development. Let me just, because I only have 10 minutes, so the slides, there are about 19 slides, so I'm going to go through some of these slides relatively quickly. Let me just mention that China has had historically a very strong commitment to science and technology, right, starting from 1978, and there are different milestones of that commitment. In terms of the R&D expenditure as a percentage share of the GDP, and this is a sort of a common measure of a country's resource allocation to science and technology. For many, many years, China's ratio stayed at 1%, less than 1%. But in the more recent years, it has risen to 1.7% GDP in 2009. And last year, I think it has reached 2%. So what does 2% mean? 2% basically means that you're spending roughly at the OECD level, right? OECD is basically developed economies, US, Japan, Europe. And so there you're seeing the level between 2 and 3%. So there's for a country at a still fairly low per capita GDP, right? China's GDP per capita is only about $6,000 using the PPP exchange rate, as compared with almost 50,000 in the United States. So at a fraction of the US GDP, China is spending quite a lot of money on R&D, and that shows the policy and political commitments. The issue here is, what does the country get from this huge investments in R&D? If you look at other measures, the number of college graduates in 2011, 6.6 million, massive increase. In 1999, only 1.5 million. Lot of PhD students and master students. And China has had a history of scientific achievements, right? Even before the recent increase of investments in science and technology. It is the only developing country that has participated in the Human Genome Project, and first the developing country to have a manned space program. In terms of the publication, scientific publications now, it's ranked second in engineering publications. The data are a little bit old, from 2005, and probably the ranking has increased in the more recent years. And we have, a number of us have assembled a database on Chinese scientific publications. So these are not journalistic publications. These are peer-reviewed scientific publications, papers published by Chinese scientists. You see massive increase in the last 10 years. So this is the graph showing the number of the publications, and as you can see, that the huge increase started in the late 1990s, and now China is publishing over 100,000 papers a year. In what is known as SCI indexed journals, citation index journals, that's basically the those journals that are viewed as having high impact. Let me skip some of these because I want to get. There are definitely achievements, but there are also challenges and problems. One issue has to do with the quality vis-a-vis quantity of Chinese scientific publications. And the Chinese educational system emphasizes rote memorization and there are problems with China is graduating all these college students, but the employment rate is low. So there's an issue of whether or not there's a match between what the Chinese educational system is producing and what the Chinese economy is demanding. And there's even corruption among academics. Professors can be corrupt. I have no idea how professors can be corrupt, so I need to learn how it is done. And they're cheating, so there are all sorts of problems with the Chinese scientific and educational institutions. So it's a mixed record. There are achievements, there are also problems. The issue for us is we need to think about the net impact of these developments. For example, if you look at the number of the publications, China now is ranked second relative to the United States in terms of the number. But if you judge the impact of Chinese publications in terms of citation and all of that, it's only ranked ninth among countries in the world. So, and let me just point to one feature of this graph, which is that this is a measure called journal impact factor. And the higher you go, the more impact the particular paper has, right? So it's really not the number of publications that matters. It's really the impact. What is amazing is that if you see many of these fields, this is divided by fields, chemistry, computer science, a lot of the fields are actually pretty flat. So you have this huge increase in terms of the number of the publications, but in terms of the impact, that has remained quite stable over time, except in life science and biology. And what is very interesting there is that in life science and biology, it is the high impact is probably completely a function of international collaborations. And so this is a key difference between China and some people now compare China with Soviet Union. Soviet Union in the 1960s and 70s also had basic research. But one key difference is that China is achieving some of this scientific accomplishments by engaging deeply in international collaborations. We have looked at biology and life science. It's called Nature X, so the papers published in Nature magazine and its affiliated magazines, 80% of the Chinese publications there are done through international collaboration. So I think this is a key. So Steve framed the issue as sort of competition, arms race, but I think there is a collaborative component to the relationship between China and the rest of the world that we should really emphasize. Let me just end with maybe two more slides to demonstrate that the problems there are problems with the Chinese R&D, but there are also potentials. One huge problem is that in the West, we think about universities as a republic of science, right? So freedom, autonomy, openness, collaboration, peer review. In China, basically, it's republic of government, right? Government officials, party secretaries, university presidents, the deans, and, you know, at U.S. university, as Denis may disagree because he's a university official. In the U.S. university, officials, deans, and president, they don't really matter that much. I mean, it's really the professors. And so, but in China, it's quite, well, except Denis. And well, they matter in a sort of fundraising, but they don't matter in a control way, right? Whereas in China, it's there's very top control system, even in the university system. My own view is that this is not a system conducive to breakthrough development, despite the fact that they have achieved quite a bit with whatever system that they have. This is a cartoon showing, this is another problem in the Chinese educational system, which is pursuit of money. You can publish, and then you get paid by the number of papers you publish, right? So this is a scientist, youngish looking scientist. The scale is money, and he's holding the papers that he has published. So I think that's a problem, because it is incentivizing short-term research, repetitive research, rather than truly innovative research. So let me just end by saying that that as China wants to move toward innovation and true technology, true science, the system has to change. There has to be more freedom. There has to be more protection of intellectual property rights. All this discussion about how unique China is and how successful the China model is, how different it is from the West, I think all of that will go away when China needs to move toward an innovation-driven economy. China has a lot of leeway now because it is basically catching up with the West. Once the gap between China and the West is closing, is narrow, it has no choice but to adopt a system that I think many people in this room are familiar with. Whether or not it has to completely adopt the Western system, that's a separate issue. But I think the larger point is that it has to move toward that system. Thank you very much.
That was a very good talk. Thank you very much, Yasheng. We're going to bring you up when we have the Q&A. We're going to move. So let me introduce our panelists. So starting right here to my right, Yifei Sun is a professor of geography at California State University, Northridge. I grew up one block
really?
From this university.
Oh, nice.
Studying economic geography in China, particularly in technological innovation and urban regional economic development. He edited the book Global R&D in China.
With my friend here.
Okay. All right. Then we have Denis Simon. He's the Vice Provost for International Strategic Initiatives and Professor of Global Studies at Arizona State University. He previously worked in business consulting in China, serving as director of the China Strategy Group and general manager of Anderson Consulting's China practice. He's the co-author, most recently, of China's Emerging Technological Edge, Assessing the Role of High-End Talent. And finally, we have Adam Segal at the end. He's a senior fellow at the Council on Foreign Relations, specializing in technology and development in China and India. He's the author of Advantage: How American Innovation Can Overcome the Asian Challenge. It argues that the U.S. can preserve its position as an economic powerhouse by strengthening its politics, social relations, and institutions. He argues that Americans
software, as he calls it, will prevail, and Chinese software is an impediment to a truly innovative economy. The first thing I want to start out by asking, I want to set a base of discussion, and that's that, is there even a reason to be having this discussion? Has the United States, has the West completely exaggerated this issue of an innovation and race with China as part of it, of its concern about a rising Chinese juggernaut? Adam?
I think there has been a tendency to overstate where Chinese innovation is right now and what type of threat it faces now to U.S. competitiveness. But I think it's important to have the conversation because the issue isn't so much, I think, part of the issue is, will China become innovative? But the other issue from the U.S. perspective is, what does the Chinese system look like? Is it going to be an open, collaborative, global system, or is it going to be a more techno-nationalistic, mercantilist system? And there's a debate in China about which of those systems best serves their purposes. As Yasheng's presentation pointed out, so much of the big breakthroughs have happened collaboratively. But if you look at the policies on technology standards, indigenous innovation, IPR protection, there's a strong push towards these more techno-nationalistic arguments.
Okay, let me move to Denis. Follow-up to that question. Yasheng framed the question as the race, looking at this as a race, is wrong. It's more, we should look at our relationship as a collaborative one. Do you agree with that?
I agree, because in many ways, if you think of the global problems that are out there in the world today, there probably is no global problem that's not going to require some kind of close, intimate collaboration between the United States and China in order to resolve that problem. That means if you look at the evolution of our two systems, increasingly the collaboration is happening at the faculty level, at the researcher level, and that even with all the problems at the macro level in our bilateral relationship, science and technology cooperation continues to grow and expand every year. So there is almost a natural force bringing the two countries together, and that in many ways, if we don't figure out how to leverage that, and if we look at it a race rather than kind of a plus-plus, you know, win-win game, I think that we'll end up having ourselves faced with a self-fulfilling prophecy, which will be China will become an adversarial player in the game rather than a collaborative one.
Great. I wanted to just say, to the degree that you would like to address each other, question each other, feel free to do that. One of the big questions that I've had looking at this issue is U.S. labs, U.S. technology companies, science companies have moved into China, IBM, Microsoft, Intel, and formed gigantic research labs. They employ local scientists in these labs. If China truly, as Yasheng has framed, has made most of its breakthroughs in collaboration, then one ought to see something going on in these labs. I'm wondering to what degree are we seeing breakthroughs in those labs, and what kind of innovations are they? Are they made by Chinese on their own? Are they collaboration? Yeah.
You want to ask me, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you very much. I think it's a trend. We cannot deny it. More and more foreign or Western multinational corporations, they're moving their R&D into China. And they're growing. It's not deniable. It's a fact. Has been last for at least a decade. And in terms of what they're doing in China, I think there are two things, maybe three things. One is basic research. Second is product development. Third is sales or service. Basically, it's a marketing tool. Okay. In terms of the level of sophistication, what they're doing, are there any breakthroughs? No. What essentially, you say, many people, you know, many of us here or in the academic field think, when we think about a research, basically, wow, that's super, right? you're doing something big. But, you know, you need to tell the subtle difference. When I did the interview work on the project many years ago, a few years, not many years ago, and when I asked them, why you guys start like Microsoft? They did not start with a development lab in China. IBM, same thing. They start with research. Why? Because research is a basket. You could put anything in it. You could do nothing, or you can do a lot. Research is just the slogan, okay? To show, hey, I'm doing something for you guys, because Chinese government, in the late 90s, they started to realize that we cannot just adopt the market for technology strategy. It doesn't work, because foreign companies won't do any substantial R&D work in China. They simply use the cheap labor and take advantage of the cheap, the regular environment regulation, those kind of things, and make money, and they leave. So Chinese government say, let's come over here. Come here, do something. We're going to give you some good things. So foreign companies, OK, because in order to get entry into the Chinese market, the kind of Chinese government said, you have to put some R&D here. So the foreign companies say, OK, I will do some. See, I'm doing something. Research, basic research. You guys like basic research, right? But it's nothing. OK, basically, it's nothing. And then gradually, they found out, well, we cannot just show, just put up some show. We need to do something real, because the Chinese market is growing. We cannot deny that. And the Chinese, like Yasheng mentioned, the university and education, the graduates do the engineering, has been crazy. Okay, so they have the talent with relatively good skill and cheap relative to our cost here. So why don't we do something good for the market, even not just for the Chinese local market, also for the global market? So it's, but you don't see big breakthroughs yet. Maybe in the future, there's something in their pipeline. But I have not seen anything big from those labs. So, you know, most of the most sophisticated stuff, the research and development, are still done here in the United States. Talking about Intel, same thing. We had the conference, we had the workshop many years ago. We asked the director in R&D, Intel research in Nanjing, and he did a presentation basically saying what? Intel is different from other companies. We're very conservative. We don't want to put the most advanced things in China, period. Okay? Microsoft, same thing. Okay? Even now, they have the largest facility outside United States, in Beijing. They call it Asian Research Institute. They have development, their research, have engineering labs, and they're still not doing, they're not a breakthrough. Even in the media, they say, oh, we have done this, that, try to make good face. For who? For the Chinese government.
There are two things just to comment on. One is that the Chinese government itself actually has mixed views about this. There definitely is one contingent that believes that getting multinationals to move up the value chain, engaging in R&D, that looks good. It feeds into this drive to become an innovation economy. But there is another group that seriously questions the value and the utility of having these multinationals come and engage in sort of enclave-like research that really doesn't spill over. Now, if you go back and you look at the experience of places like Taiwan, for example, in the 70s and early 80s, one of the advantages of having these R&D activities going on is the career mobility. Yeah. So people will work for Microsoft, people will work for Intel, and then 5 years later they'll go out and they'll start their own companies. Mm-hmm. And that was a very, very powerful inducement to the development of Taiwan's high-tech industries. Mm-hmm. That same phenomenon is starting to happen. The most famous individual is Kai-Fu Lee, who's now left the jobs at Intel and Microsoft and now become a leading technological entrepreneur. Mm-hmm. He represents the vanguard of a whole group of people that potentially could create that kind of capability. Yeah. But we must remember that even the Chinese government itself is uncertain about how much benefit they're really getting from these R&D operations at this point in time.
Yes. Is the Chinese government then is ambivalent about this dimension of the economy? What about the whole matter, the discussion we're having today about innovation? Is there ambivalence that it's needed?
There was absolutely no ambivalence whatsoever. If you look at, one of the problems Chinese leaders face is that they have so many issues that they've got to confront. But this transition to a knowledge economy is one of the highest imperatives. It's an imperative because it has to happen in order for China to prevent it from having a long-term natural resource disaster, a long-term environmental disaster, and also having tremendous amount of problems in terms of its future competitive position in the global economy. There is no doubt that Chinese leaders recognize they can no longer sustain themselves as a cheap labor economy. And they can no longer have that high degree of dependency on fossil fuel burning industries. They can no longer have that high level of dependence on consuming large quantities of natural resources. They've got to move away from an economic model that was built on their past success and start to discover new sources of value creation in their economy. If they don't do that, they will find themselves at the bottom of the competitive listing rather than somewhere near the top where they want. And it's very clear by their 100th anniversary, which is 2049, I mean, they intend to have China as one or two top countries in the world in terms of innovation capability and innovative performance. So this is not just a face question. There are structural drivers that are pushing the Chinese economy in this direction. Right.
Adam, on the question of structural drivers, so a few years ago, China identified electric cars and batteries as an area in which it was going to make a technological leap. This hasn't happened, and so the whole question of identifying an area and being able, you argue that structurally there's a problem, that China, you suggest China cannot make this leap in this under the current situation. Can you explain that?
Sure. We've talked about all the strengths of the Chinese system, the strategic view, the size of the market, this increasing knowledge production. But the argument that I make is that we've been overly focused on what I call the hardware of innovation, right? All of the inputs, S&T spending, papers, how many people we publish, and we have focused less on the software, which is the social, political, and cultural understandings that help move an idea from the lab to the marketplace. So then those are all of the other things that Yasheng mentioned, intellectual property rights, the ability for young scientists to choose their own projects as opposed to being told what they're going to focus on. Do they feel comfortable criticizing their seniors? Do they feel comfortable going off on wasting time on failing? All these things that we see as a kind of much more productive scientific environment. The problem structurally is that right now the state is so focused on innovation for all the reasons that Denis mentioned, plus the added feature of they don't want to be dependent on the West. So I think we have to hammer that home, is that it's not that they only want to be technologically innovative. They want to reduce dependence on the U.S. and Japan and the EU for the technologies to make sure that they can get out of this technology trap, is that the government sets the incentives for the types of technologies. And we know that the Chinese government is no better than the U.S. government in picking what technologies are going to succeed. And so that you see those large failures in batteries, much like the U.S. has been having problems with solar panels and wind farms, that you just can't focus it from the top down. The issue longer term is, how do you build a platform for innovation? And those things are harder to do. That requires social and political change. That's going to take time. And I think Denis is exactly right. It's people like Kai-Fu Lee and the universities and faculty that are going to make those changes.
All right. But, you know, China is not going to innovate in the same way that the U.S. has. It's not going to do it in the same way that Europe has. Why can't there be a collective form of genius? A collective form of innovation?
I mean, we definitely, look, I think in the U.S. we tend to have a model of innovation that's based most recently on Silicon Valley, right? We think it's got to be universities and small startups, and it's going to create the next big thing. And that's not the only model, right? We know, for example, the Japanese model of much bigger firms, huge expenditures over decades, right? So the Japanese kept the same labs together in recession and growth. And they made incremental change over time. It may be that Chinese SOEs, when they start ramping up R&D spending, which they're doing, may adopt that model, and there may be breakthroughs. I think the issue is, when people say, oh, China is innovative, we're not talking narrow sectors, we're talking about the entire system. And that just doesn't seem to be in place.
See,
No, I would make the argument that we have to look at where the discontinuities in the system are likely to occur. So, for example, if you look at the array of state-owned enterprises that seem to dominate the economy, will they become the major sources of innovation, or are we likely to see an entirely new industrial architecture emerge in China, of which there are a series of firms that are just now emerging that will provide the vanguard for this innovation? Now, one argument would be, well, the state is over-concentrating its resources and its attention on these state-owned enterprises with the expectation that they will become innovative. Just 2 days ago, for example, the Chinese Academy of Sciences signed an agreement with a number of state-owned enterprises in order to create this kind of almost a tight linkage to promote innovation inside the SOEs, because it's sort of not happening because of their quasi-monopolistic position. Over time, one wonders, is that going to be the genesis of innovation in China, or are we likely to see a whole new series of companies begin to emerge? For example, all of these returnees that are going back, the young technological entrepreneurs who are under the 1,000 talent program and other kinds of programs like this, it seems to me that these people are more likely to become this vanguard of technological entrepreneurship in China rather than the existing industrial organizations that continue to dominate the economy, particularly during this first 30 years of the reform and opening up.
Adam was talking about the structure problem of the Chinese innovation system somewhere. To some extent, I do agree. There is a huge problem with the Chinese structure, and which prevent creativity and innovation. But on the other hand, I think we need to redefine, some way we need to define innovation. What is innovation? Innovation means every day we come up with iPod, iPad, or come up with some kind of nuclear weapon, something like that. That means innovation. Or something more incremental, daily life, which affects your daily life. Okay. So in China, I think Dennis mentioned, they're basically, we had a workshop last year. We think there are two modes of innovation. Chinese is not the innovation system. Actually, there's no way to characterize the Chinese innovation. There are ways of innovation. Chinese ways, not a way. So one is a state-dominated sector. That sector, in my personal opinion, does not have so much hope. Oh, it's broadcasting to China now, okay. Second part, and Dennis mentioned, is about the private or non-state, because the private is kind of a weird term in China. You don't, the private thing covered wide range of activities, all kinds of firms. So that's the most vibrant part of the economy. If you go to the firms, you talk to the business, those people are very entrepreneurship, very adventure risk-taking. They're willing to do anything they like to move forward. Innovation, most of firms don't have innovations, be honest with you. Even in the most important sector, like information technology, communication technology, the industry, they're not much. But they're pockets of excellence. There are firms who are doing excellent job, Huawei, Zhongxing, ZTE, you learn about it, right? It's in the big hotspot now, they're in the trouble, okay? But also look at the returnees, many of the firms, like in the ICT industry, in the IC design sector and also the fabrication sector. You look at those firms, why there are suddenly so many? Why, you know, how they're doing? I have to tell you, many of them are very, very successful. Their strategy is not to compete with Apple. No, they're not competing with Microsoft. They're not competing with Intel. What they're doing is try to come up with a good enough project. They look into iPod, iPad. Oh, that stuff pretty good, okay? But too pricey, we cannot afford it. What are we gonna do? Lower the price, come up with something. Functionality, there's no difference, maybe just a subtle difference, 90%, 80%, but it's much, much cheaper. How cheaper? 50%, do you want it? For the mass of Chinese market, or for the majority of the world, that's the future, because nobody, not so many people can afford iPad anyway.
Okay, stop it. So, yep. This is a time-tested model. Japan, South Korea, what's wrong with this? Why does China have to become an innovative juggernaut? Why can't it just do this?
It's a political question. It's a question of political desire. China is a large continental economy. Yeah. It has global ambitions. It has had a history in which its dependence on the West for everything from trade to technology has been a source of problems and difficulties. And so just simply allowing itself to be in so-called also-ran technologically is not something that's politically acceptable to the leadership. So there's a book that's come out recently, A Run of the Red Queen, which has basically talked precisely about this, that China would be better off being an incremental innovator rather than a radical innovator. And even if that was true in terms of the nature of Chinese capabilities, the reality is that it's unacceptable to the leadership. The leadership itself sees China as becoming a major player in world science and technology affairs, and they are positioning the country in order to put themselves in that position. So even if the reality, you know, if I was a consultant to the Chinese government and I said to them, no, incremental innovation is the way you ought to go, they would probably say, well, thank you very much. We'll see you tomorrow. You know, we'll see you again.
All right. So China can get where it wants to go economically based on tinkering, so-called process innovation. However, politically speaking, it's not acceptable, so the government is pushing for these gigantic leaps. The structural impediments that you three have described, the cultural impediments, regulatory, we're sitting in Washington, they know that. So why don't they just fix it?
The Chinese
leadership certainly knows before any of you guys knew it.
Oh, yeah. They know everything. Like the because they are the insider, right? We know much less than President Hu or Premier Wen knows, okay? And they have lots of people working for them. They have big think tanks. They know. But to solve those problems takes lots of things. Your courage, your political capital, okay? And even look at the current China, it's not one party controls everything. There are segments in Chinese own language. They have interest groups which controls the operation of the country. Even the leader, I trust President Hu, I trust the Premier Wen. They do want to move the country forward. They know the political system has a problem. But how? Where to start? Lots of people, you got the bull and the bull guy, right? And try to surround them, hey, don't do it. If you do it, we're going to get you down first, and then you end up with nothing. So there are lots of concerns. Just the President Obama, he understands we need to move forward. But how? You got Capitol Hills surround you. Say, no, we don't want to move that direction. The same thing, it's not the one person controls everything. So they know the problem. But they also know the solution. But between the problem and the solution, there is a huge gap and lots of hurdles that you need to figure out.
Yeah, I mean, Yifei is making an excellent point. We're right in the middle of the succession struggle, which we don't have any idea how it's going to turn out. We know that, you know, basically everyone's going to be new. And we know, as Yifei was going to say, that the next generation of leadership is going to be even more consensual than Wen Jiabao and Hu Jintao were, which means that the ability to force through difficult reforms is probably going to be decreased. We don't know for sure, but that's most likely. So the Chinese leadership is at this position where, as Yasheng and other people have described, that they have to make this shift to consumer-driven economy. They have to rein in the export-led model. But those are going to require difficult reforms of increasing the size of the private market, shrinking the state market, reforming the financial system. All these things that they all know they have to do, but how they're going to get there is not an easy question. The 2006 mid to long-term science and technology plan, which lays out all these goals and is very, very top-down and talks about indigenous innovation, the second half of it is all, no, we need property rights protection, we need to have small startups, we need to have better university-industry collaboration. So yes, they know all of this, right? They've been to Silicon Valley probably more times than any of us, right? They know that model. But politically, it's just not, you know, we have this vision that the Chinese can just snap their fingers and get there. That's just not happening any longer. And it's going to get harder as they go forward.
So just this past July, there was a major national science and technology and innovation conference. Mm-hmm. It's held over 2 or 3 days. All of the major leaders spoke. But that conference was just the tip of a process over the last 12 months at least, mm-hmm. in which Hu Jintao and Zhao Bao and various other leaders have made extremely critical speeches about the lack of performance of the innovation system. More or less, they said, we put money, we've got enough people, we bought a lot of new equipment, and yet the performance is lagging. When you look at even the indicators, whether Yasheng pointed to patents or citations, the record looks very impressive, but the reality on the ground in terms of commercial technologies just isn't there. So the leadership has basically now tried to crack down. One of the things that they are trying to do is emphasize more on small to medium enterprises as the source of innovative ideas, innovative thinking. Again, that's where these returnees become very, very important in the businesses they start. But they're also trying to push the locus of innovation activities from the top down to the local level. So you started to see this year, for example, the local government share of the expenditures on R&D actually exceeding that of the central government. So it was something like 51, 52 to 49, you know, just a little bit of a change, but enough of a change to mean that more and more of the activity that's going to go on is going to be supported and driven at the local level where the innovative activity actually takes place. That is a systemic change because there's been too much power, too much influence, too much concentration in the Ministry of Science and Technology, and there was even a proposal running around through the rumor mill that the Ministry of Science and Technology should be abolished, and that its function should be divided up between the Ministry of Industry and Information Technology and the Ministry of Education. That probably wasn't practical. But the fact that this kind of radical idea even was broached and made its rounds through the rumor mill suggests that radical thinking about how to fix this system is making its way into the policymaking circles. So that's a good sign. Yeah. It's a good sign, actually.
Yeah, it is.
So, it's good for China, it's good for Chinese, if it does make this jump, you get this new age in 2049, as Denis suggested. Does it matter to the rest of the world? Should we?
Oh yeah.
Yeah, why?
Well, you got the giant dragon over there in the wake, and some people would see as a positive sign, wow, we have a huge market, now we can sell our stuff over there. Right? But for many others, they see another world. That's a scary dragon. It has, you know, we never seen it before. And particularly in this country, I think now there is in a panic mode, my personal assessment. Okay, it's live, I know. But, you know, because China's economy has been growing, still growing at a pace like 7-8%, even we call it very slow in Chinese standard. Okay, here we're suffering. Okay, we're suffering. So now we're used to be number one, the one and the only one. We had this former Soviet Union. We beat it. It's gone. Now suddenly we got some guy like China, okay, still under Communist Party's control. And we are capitalism. We call them communist, but actually Chinese is more capitalist like than in America, I have to tell you. You know, we don't like socialism, right? But America is more socialist-like than China. And the Chinese government does not take care of so many poor people. We do here. So here's the question, why we're in a panic? In my judgment, China's innovation matters to the whole world, to the United States, and it will help to solve many problems on the one hand. On the other hand, we're gonna have a strong competitor or collaborator. If we ignore it, that's not gonna work. We won't be able to solve those big problems. And then we may end up in bigger problem ourselves. So we have to work together.
This is an argument about race, about the race. Isn't it good for the United States if China grows really, really big and innovative?
I think it goes back to the point I opened with. It depends which system the Chinese build, right? And I think, look, we haven't even mentioned the claims about cyber espionage, right? If they're just stealing terabytes of data, then the issue is that they are building a system. They're tilting the playing field in such a way that the growth of China is not a good thing for the United States, right? It attacks U.S. competitiveness. I mean, we have basically made a bet that we're going to build this global international system, and we can all have this win-win situation that I agree with Denis, that is the goal. But if the Chinese are basically exploiting that system through cyber espionage, through IPR theft, through mercantilist policies, then I think, yeah, it's clearly a threat. It's clearly a risk to U.S. competitiveness, and it's one that the U.S. has to respond to.
Mike Lampton at the NHTSA School has written an interesting book about China. He said that China can play one of three roles: rule breaker, rule maker, rule taker. So the question really is, what are the terms and conditions upon which China's rise will occur, and how will it play in the international system? So if it plays by the rules, you know, and again, those rules were set, you know, as part of the Bretton Woods system and the post-war order. That order now clearly has changed. China now is going to shape the evolution of that system. If we look at Chinese participation in international standards organizations, the Internet Health Organizations, environmental organizations, etc., we now see a pronounced increase in Chinese presence, in Chinese activism, because China realizes that it must shape this new world order, can no longer just simply sit in the back room, can no longer sit on the side of the room, but now is really at the table, actively shaping and orchestrating how that world will occur. Now, clearly, we're not going to have the totality of power and influence that we once had to make those rules in accordance with where we would like them to be. But we also don't want China to be a disruptive force in terms of the international order to turn it on its head either. So I think that we need to invite the Chinese into this system, have them feel comfortable that there are benefits from playing by the rules, or at least by the rulemaking processes, and not engage in the kind of activities that Adam was referring to, because those basically are destructive. And whether it's at a bilateral or multilateral level, they're not going to win China a lot of friends, and probably will preempt a great amount of the collaboration that could occur because of the anxieties that that kind of behavior might create.
All right, so we should invite China into the room. We should have a civil discussion, not to steal our stuff.
Some wrist slapping here and there, yeah.
But the discussion began with collaboration, and you are involved specifically in collaboration. You guys have all talked down China's inherent homegrown ability to contribute to the innovative superstructure. And so I want, you know, shouldn't I care about my own country? Why should we collaborate with China?
Okay. Why we should cooperate with China? I think it's good for China for sure, because they're catching up, right? And you help them, they move up. That's one thing for sure. Second, I think we have to recognize it's good for America here. Americans benefit from collaboration with China. Like Dennis, like me, we're doing research, right? And we co-publish with our Chinese colleagues. And what we do, what we have is something here. But what we don't have is money. And also the labor. What they have, now the Chinese government pushed lots of money into it. The students are growing. And they have time, they have money. Together, we team up. So in the end, both sides benefit. They learn the tricks, how to publish, how to do research. American side, we have the resource. We tap into the Chinese source and work on something bigger. On our own, simply, it's impossible. That's from my perspective, academic perspective, right? From the industrial, same thing. And we work with China. We work on the new next generation products, technologies. China, of course, will have access to those technologies if we work with them, okay? If they work with us. Okay? And American companies, they use Chinese sources as well. The cheap, relative cheap engineers, scientists, why not? And we have, it will improve our American companies' competitiveness in the whole world, right? And you say, oh, you're moving jobs to China. I say, no. You may have jobs in China, R&D jobs in China. But you need to think, without those R&D jobs in China, where will US companies go? You want to move R&D to the UK? You may, but they don't have that many people. If you don't do that, companies from other countries will go to China. And then the American companies will be in big trouble, because we'll lose the competitiveness. So in the end, American companies benefit from those kind of activity. And American taxpayers, American citizens benefit from that, because American companies, they're making money. Well, we need to require them to pay us back. We simply let them go. Oh, keep money in your pocket. Well, that's our own institutional problem, right? So I think both sides, and it's going to be good for the world, because U.S., China, those are two big economies. If they work together, they're going to solve some big problems together for the human beings, not just for Chinese, not just for Americans. It's for all the human beings. So that's my...
But Dennis, I want the United States to be the biggest and the best. Why should we do that?
Well, because I think that in many ways, if we look at the emerging technologies, so for example, let's take clean energy. So now there is a bilateral consortium between the United States and China to develop clean energy technologies in three areas: clean buildings, clean coal, and electric cars. And we negotiated over a 12 to 18 month period all the intellectual property requirements to ensure that nobody was going to get an unfair advantage and that everyone's interests would be protected. That was the most difficult negotiation in part of the bilateral relationship among many that we've had. But we finally came to closure, we reached that agreement, and now we've set off a number of teams working together collaboratively. I think you have to be careful not to isolate just this in terms of bilateral terms. You have to look at the global innovation system as a whole. Innovation as a process is becoming more transborder, more cross-cultural, and more cross-functional. So it means that the research and new knowledge creation today is no longer the product of a kind of lone ranger phenomena. It's the product of collaborative networks that include researchers and scientists from all different domains. You can look at U.S. universities. Professors get their salaries maybe at their university where they're physically, you know, supposedly located, but really the successful scientists today are people who are really engaged and embedded in these groups all over the world, and they're part of research teams where money, resources, knowledge are created, irrespective of time and place. And so in many ways, this is not just a dream anymore. This is the reality of how things work. You look at the best universities, you look at the best faculty. If your faculty is sitting in their office 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, they're doing something wrong. They really need to be globally engaged. And if they're not globally engaged, what the Chinese are doing is they're sending their people all over the world. They're expanding the engagements and level of interaction at the university level, at the think tank level. In a couple of weeks, the Chinese Academy of Sciences, for the fifth year, will send a delegation to the United States of senior institute directors from their best institutes. There will be 25 or 30 of them. They will go all around the United States. They'll spend time in Arizona. They'll be in Washington. They'll be in New York. They're trying to gauge where's the state of the art. Where is research processes going? What are the new issues on the agenda in terms of potential collaborative arrangements with the United States? They'll take that back and they'll reformulate their strategies and thinkings about how they're going to re-engage with the world. One of the things that has to be clear is that despite all of this talk about indigenous innovation, China has not retreated one step from engaging in the global economy and the global innovation system. Every Chinese leader has made it clear that China's future success is dependent not only what they do domestically, but just as much of what they do in terms of their international collaborative activity.
Adam?
I mean, I think Dennis and Yves hit the three main points. The first is there's more science being done in China, and some of it's getting very good. Yasheng mentioned life science biology. I think you could also mention nanotechnology, right? That's another area where they've really done some big breakthroughs. We don't want to miss those breakthroughs, right? So that means you have to have American universities, you have to have American companies there. The second is, as Dennis mentioned, any global problem is going to need a global solution. And in particular, you're going to need countries like China, India, and Brazil to drive the price down through large-scale manufacturing, right? We see this in the environmental technologies, right? What has China's role been is to bring solar panels prices down so they become almost economically viable for those solutions. It's going to be same true for drugs and other kind of these other global problems. The third is, and you know, here I'm less sure of myself, but we are as there is still a socialization process of China going on in China, right? So that we've all mentioned this debate about what is the best innovation system look like, right? Is it more open or is it more focused on China? And the collaboration, I think, reinforces Chinese views that, yes, they can benefit, they can gain from this system, and that it's not stacked against them. I am beginning to lose patience with that argument. I mean, I've been making that argument for 20 years now, but I'm beginning to wonder, you know, how the mistrust between the two sides is large and growing, and that after a while we may have to start using the stick more than the carrot. But I think those are the three main reasons why we should, why collaboration is the right reason. But we may be hedging more often.
Okay, let's open this up. Yasheng, can I invite you up? Adam, just stay here? Okay, if you have a question, please identify yourself and just indicate who you're addressing the question to. Sir? Please wait for the microphone, yeah.
My name is Edward. I'm working at the European Union, and the question is open for everyone. What do you anticipate the role of Europe will be in the relationship between the US and China going forward?
Well, I'm in the middle of finishing the book about China and the global innovation system, which actually a good part of it's devoted to the China-EU relationship. I think there's a very interesting triangular relationship emerging, a kind of competitive dynamic. The EU, in my view, is trying to wean China away from its excessive dependence on the United States. And also, I think the EU realizes that having access to China's scientific and technical talent pool is a very big asset, potentially, to help boost and support a lot of the initiatives that are going on in Europe at this present time. So I think the collaboration in some ways between the EU and China is much more in-depth, much more extensive than it is with the United States in a number of areas, and it's starting to grow faster. So while we're slowing down in some areas, particularly in the bilateral government-to-government side, Europe and China seem to be moving much faster. And I think a lot of this has to do with the EU itself pushing and trying to drive that relationship. Doesn't mean that everything is going very well. There are a number of problems. IPR issues are also very big with Europe, as they are with the United States. There are some legacies left over from in terms of arms sales issues that are also standing in the way. And then there is just some of the political issues that have to do with human rights and other kinds of things that affect that general relationship. But nonetheless, I think that Europe is moving much more quickly and much more decidedly in seeing how to harness China's talent resources and intellectual resources in a way that we could actually learn from in some situations.
Yeah, I think China's innovation, you know, as Denis mentioned, even they have put up the slogan of indigenous innovation. This is a really, really weird term to categorize the innovation they want. The people have some misunderstandings on this term. When people look at this from, oh, you want to lock you up? You don't want, you want to kick us out? And you don't need us anymore? Is that what I mean? No. Denis organized a workshop many years ago after the 2006. The Ministry of Science and Technology, people asked, what do you mean indigenous innovation? Well, his answer was, I still remember. He said, indigenous means innovation, period. Innovation. Why do they want to put indigenous? It's a political term to appease the domestic, some fragments of people. We want our own technology, right? Everybody wants that. So that's a misunderstanding. And then Europe is, as Denis said, is playing a significant role in the US China relationship, or maybe in China's innovation. We just leave US aside for the time being. Chinese system is open. It's not closed. It's not just open to the United States. It's open to everyone. Okay, Europe particularly is very important. Look at the foreign companies already in China. Germany, the German companies are very active, very, very active in China. Okay, they're doing something really big, maybe bigger than what our companies do in China. And then putting into the question the China-US relationship, I think Europe definitely, China will try to use Europe as a leverage. Hey, do you want to work with us? If you don't, okay, we're going to work with German, with a French company, right? So EU definitely is playing a significant role in this process.
Okay. Next. Sir?
Hi, I'm Brian Fung. I'm a writer at The Atlantic, and my question is for the entire panel. In the past couple weeks, we've seen sort of protectionist and defensive sentiments pick up in the United States toward China. I'm just wondering whether you see that as more of a temporary hiccup or as sort of a sign of the limits of economic cooperation between the two countries.
I think you probably have to differentiate. I think there's the campaign rhetoric, which I'm assuming is just cyclical, right? That it's driven by the elections, and that whoever wins is unlikely to dramatically change our economic relationship with China. I think Huawei and the wind farm issue is not. I think that's structural, and the security side of that relationship, the security side of the economic relationship, is not going anywhere, and it's going to continue to be difficult, and will continue to bounce along.
I think there's clearly a political component to the rhetoric. Maybe the level of the rhetoric is a function of politics. But the issues are real issues, right? So the exchange rate issues, the imbalance of the trade and things like that, IP protection. I think, you know, leaving the politics aside, I think there's a way to address these issues in a productive way. And there's a way to address these issues in an unproductive way. And either for political reasons or for ideological reasons, you know, there are people in this country who have an explicit agenda to taint these fairly technical issues with very, very harmful rhetoric. On my first day, I'm going to declare China a currency manipulator. By the way, my own preference is not to see him as a that first day happens. quite apart from China, and the problem with that view is, you know, the exchange rate definitely is an issue, but the thing is, the exchange rate is really not driving the fundamental issues, the imbalances between China and the United States. China has a high savings rate, US has a low savings rate. I actually think that the trade issues are structural rather than cyclical. It's built in that structure. If you consume a lot, you don't save a lot, you have to borrow. And the trade deficit is a way of borrowing from the rest of the world. If you don't borrow from China, then you have to borrow from somebody else, right? So the issue is really not about trade deficit per se. The issue is really about this domestic imbalances between China, within the United States. And also there are domestic imbalances within China too. The country is investing too much. The country is not consuming enough. So if you frame the discussions that way, there are people on both sides there are people in both countries who can have a very meaningful dialogue about how to solve these imbalances. So I think it's really, really not very helpful to have the kind of rhetoric that we hear from some politicians in this country. You know, they have their own political agenda, but to be that specific, on my first day, I'll do this and that. Usually, you know, campaign rhetoric is framed deliberately, vaguely, right, to give you some room. I mean, what do you do on the first day of the office? I thought on the first day of, there are lots of other things. You have to go to a party and you know, a ball. And he has a time on the first day to declare China as a currency manipulator. This is just unbelievably bad.
Dennis?
Yeah, I think that also we want to look at something that's very, very important. We tended to see China coming out of the 2008 Olympics as much more assertive, much more aggressive, much more self-confident. And with that, we sort of started to attribute to the rise of China a kind of an aggressiveness that, in fact, may not have been the full picture. I think one of the things the U.S. leadership has to understand, whether it's a Romney administration or the next Obama administration, is that there's also a deep-seated anxiety that runs through the leadership in China as well. And that anxiety drives a lot of Chinese behavior. It may drive the cyber threats that we're getting. It may drive Chinese anxiety of making sure that their innovation economy is successful for fear of falling behind. There's a lot of anxiety about being able to solve many of the domestic problems, including the potential for rural instability in China, which grows every day, the environmental problems. In other words, if I'm a Chinese leader, I have a heck of an agenda that I have to deal with on a day-in, day-out basis, and I'm not really sure I can get my arms around it. the data coming out about domestic instability in China now is just going through the roof. I mean, it's grown tremendously over the last couple of years. So I think we want to be careful as we size up China and we deal with Chinese officials not to miss this element of anxiety that is underlying a lot of that behavior and not just assume it's just a bunch of cocky behavior with China pushing at the edge. I think there's a certain amount of uncertainty and uneasiness, and if we don't take that into account, we're going to make a miscalculation when we look at Chinese behavior.
Let's move to the next. This gentleman right here. Yeah.
Hello, I'm Derek Hill from the National Science Foundation. I'm curious to hear your views on China's interest and the sort of status of its collaboration with other Asian countries in innovation. For example, you know, China is the assembly point for high-tech manufactured products. Many of the components are supplied by countries like South Korea. You have some manufacturing migrating to Vietnam where the labor is cheaper. And so is China's interest mainly collaborating with the U.S., or what's the potential for a sort of Asian-centered collaboration network for innovation?
Yeah.
I think at this point, as a human being, as an individual, we always look to the leaders, right? We always want to work with Dennis, like me. I want to work with Dennis because he's more senior. He got experience. He's very successful. I'm young. I'm junior. So I have to learn from it. That's why Dennis helped me. So if we understand that psychology at the individual level, and then we can understand at the collective level as well. For Chinese, as a government, as a nation, where do they look to? They want to learn from the best. So where are the best? United States, Europe, Japan, maybe, right? You say, oh, are they willing to work with nearby, the similar, like the little brothers? Not now. Okay, my answer is not now. They may work on some issues about the resources and about the security issues. But in terms of innovation, not there yet. Only when China becomes a leader, when the little brother look to China, whoa, you're big. We need to learn from you, okay? Like U.S. assume the rule now, and then I guess the time is mature for that kind of collaboration, for China to work with the little brothers, but not now.
I've actually heard something slightly different, that there's been a push on science diplomacy in particular. A lot of it seems to be strategically motivated, so focused on Central Asia, water issues, and some other things, and Mongolia as well. So I think there has been a beginning to think about it, science diplomacy, the way we think about it in the State Department kind of sense. I know that certainly in the mid part of the last decade, the Koreans were completely freaked out about the rise of China as a science and technology power. And they moved very aggressively to kind of collaborate at the government research institute level. And of course, you know, Samsung and LG are huge presences in China. So I think the Chinese are beginning to shift that and focus out.
There are huge production collaborations among Asian countries between China and Korea and Japan, despite the Japanese protests and all of that. The biggest supplier to Apple iPhone is a Japanese company. The second biggest consists of a number of Korean companies. The third biggest consists of Taiwanese suppliers. The indigenous Chinese companies account for like 0.001% of the iPhone value added. There was a professor at UC San Diego, maybe.
Irvine.
Yeah, so who actually took out the iPhone and actually physically examined it. So it's kind of related to the question you asked about United States going after China on trade deficit. To some extent, China, we have an accounting system, international trade accounting system, that is very old, that is not accurately reflecting how the global production arrangements are today. It was devised in 19th century, 18th century, when the production, the nationality of production was super clear. Now it's not very, very clear. So a lot of the trade deficits that China incurs are a result of the production facilities moving from the rest of Asia to China. As China is beginning to move some of these operations out to Vietnam, you're going to see the migration of the trade deficit from China to Vietnam. Maybe not a big enough migration to make a difference on the bilateral relationship between China and the United States. We also see in our, by the way, National Science, I'm reviewing the proposals for you guys, and we are also going to submit a proposal. So I want to get your business card after this. And this is diplomacy. And not so subtle. We also see in our data set, as Adam pointed out, some collaboration between Chinese scientists and other Asian scientists. I really think collaboration is the theme, and both between United States and China, as well as among Asian countries. This is the best way to go forward, and we need to build a dialogue on that basis.
This will give you one very good example. Some very interesting collaboration going on between Japan, Korea, and China on the areas of standards now. Mm-hmm. Software input standards for character input systems for computers, yeah, right, and other kinds of related standards like that. Now, that's very interesting because it has potentially broad implications. One of the things that we've assumed is that the establishment of international technical standards has been a fairly smooth process. But now, if we would begin to get something called an Asian standard, for example, or standards coming out of countries that are different than the interests of the United States and Europe, for example, we could have some very interesting developments in that whole area that could affect the competitive landscape for a long term. So a lot of people are not paying very close attention to this. They think it's sort of a trite example of sort of quiet S&T diplomacy. But I would argue that as Asia begins to become more integrated and as China becomes much more of a standard setter itself, that we can begin to see the emergence of alternative locus of things like standard settings emerge over the future. So these are the kinds of issues I think that we want to have on our radar to keep our lookout for and to be able to monitor so we understand what directions China is taking the regional system in, to what extent other countries are going to follow, and to what extent the United States is going to be that chief designer that it was over the last 30, 40 years, or to what extent we're going to have to give way to a much more collaborative regime to do those kinds of things.
Scott Tong with Marketplace Public Radio. I have a when and a what question for you. Recently back from China, and I know you've all heard that the bad overuse joke that R&D there stands for receive and duplicate. When does the catch-up end? In other words, when China has to move on from the good enough model, selling $3,000 cars to emerging economies, and they hit the technology frontier, maybe when the race actually starts. The other question is, what about the financial system? Do you think that's a problem to take ideas across the valley to market?
You are asking a really tough question. Just like last night's vice president debate, you asked, when are we going to hit the 6% unemployment rate? Nobody has a good answer. They both were very vague, very, very evasive on that question. So when China is going to hit that mark you mentioned, nobody knows. President Hu doesn't know. Premier Wen doesn't know. I don't think anybody here knows when. They set the date of 2049, that's 100 years of China. And is that going to be the date? We don't know. We need to live and see if we live longer enough to see that happen, okay. Second question, what was the second question?
Financial system connecting ideas to capital.
I think there is potential. They're working on it. As Dennis mentioned, they start like the copycat of NASDAQ this year, and it's lots of small, lots of small company, innovative company there in the market now. Yeah, they're working, but the dominant state-owned banks are the dominant, will be the dominant force for a number of years. The only thing they can change is to make sure those state-owned banks, they may have more autonomy, don't just support the big you know, the SOEs, they can provide money to the small and the medium enterprise as well.
I think it's a little bit, you know, I think China's scientific research has a lot of issues. But I think it's not fair to say it's all duplication, it's all just that. The simple fact, Dennis gave one answer why China wants to do science and technology, the political imperative. I agree with that. But it's also true that this is a country that has a very deep history of scientific and technological capabilities, right? So the inventions, all of that. Even in the more recent decades, even during the Cultural Revolution, there was, you know, quite a bit of science that was going on. So in the 1930s, China had some of the quite good universities in Asia. So we're not really talking about a country that came from nowhere. This is a country that has a history really matters, and a capability really, really matters. So the issue here is whether or not you have the policy platform, an institutional platform, to translate the capabilities into the actual achievements. I think that translation is not perfect, given the financial, I'll talk about the financial, given the other, you know, top-down control and all of that. I would argue that if they relax the political controls, and by the way, China did experiment with university reforms in the 1980s, giving the faculty, you know, more control over their research agenda. All of that was changed in the 1990s. Now you have very centralized system. That's really, really counterproductive. So they put in a lot of money, they get something. You know, it's not like they get nothing, they get something. I would say that the ratio will be higher if they change to a different system. And I would argue that the Chinese leaders have the objective of science and technology, but I don't think they really, in their heart, know the delivery mechanism is actually freedom. It's really democracy. It's transparency. It is peer review. It is lack of political control rather than... They think about this issue as a function of resource commitments, and they have given the system a lot of resources. But it's a necessary condition. In this country, we have National Science Foundation. The resource commitment is very, very important. But you need to have the whole system, including the financial system. The financial system now is, if you look at the R&D composition, 5%, only 5% is devoted to basic research. Maybe the recent figure has changed.
A yeah.
Little bit higher,
little
right?
Bit higher.
So it's not actually that high. But on the other hand, the budget has increased dramatically, so the absolute amount is increasing dramatically as well. And a lot of that control is with the president of the university, Ministry of Science and Technology. I have also heard the argument that they should abolish the Ministry of Science and Technology. I don't know whether that would be a good thing, but I think that's the right discussion to have. It's really thinking about the system rather than thinking narrowly about resource commitment. I would argue that in terms of commercialization, China has a lot of private equity. Bain Capital has done very well in China, but that's in the private equity space, not in the venture capital space, which is an earlier stage. And venture capital space is yet to develop. And Li Kaifu, those people are trying to do something about it, because massive amount of that kind of investment is in the later stage rather than in the early stage.
Would you like to say?
Yeah, just a quick comment. I think one of the big dilemmas that they're facing as they try to answer that question really is that they look at this medium and long-term plan, for example, which is to define the landscape to 2020. So they're asking a really fundamental question. Is the problem one of simple implementation? Do we get different people in here? We, you know, tinker with some organizations? Or again, is there really a major structural impediment in the way the system is configured? And this national conference that they held in July began to get at some of those issues, is to begin to attack the basic fundamental problem of the system, which they've attributed to both Hongguan, you know, macro level, and Weiguan at the local level. And they've got to fix both those kinds of problems, because what's happening is that the system is not meshing together. They've got orchestration at the top with inputs, but implementation at the bottom level is not very effective. So if you get both of those working correctly, it's not a question of if China will become innovative. I think it will be when. And it's not a question, will China become innovative, but maybe biotech will move faster than nanotech, maybe chemistry will move faster than something else. You know, we will see a very dissynchronous set of developments in China, and a lot of this, again, will have to do with this collaborative model, I think, that will help drive some of those sectors faster than others.
Okay, we have time for two more questions.
Thank you. I'm Audrey Winter. I'm a Deputy Assistant U.S. Trade Representative for China. I'm really a student of U.S. law and a student of EU law, and China is relatively new to me. And one of the things that motivates my thinking when I think about the importance of the collaboration most of you are stating should be the basis for this ongoing relationship with China, what I see that lacks is a confidence in the amount of state capitalism that exists in China and the level of that compared to the U.S. and the EU. And when I think of it as a lawyer, I think of it in terms of our Constitution and the very big footprint it gave to the Supreme Court and to the Congress to make sure that the states didn't get in the way of competition. There are thousands of Supreme Court cases that made sure of that and opened the markets to the U.S. players and all international players. The EU, 200 years roughly later, created a similar system, giving power to a court across now from 6 to 27 member states that has to be respected to reduce the role of government in the market and in the lives of people. And what I see in the Chinese system kind of lacks that, and I wonder if some stronger force needs to be advocated in China in order for all of us to truly enjoy this collaboration that everyone wants, because we all want peace in the world, in a more equalized way. And I think the WTO rules have been shown to be somewhat deficient in this capacity. If we had the rules that we created in 1947 that never came to pass and died on the bed of post-war concern about communism, you know, can we look back to that as a way to get where we could have gone? And is there value in that in terms of both reducing frictions, economic frictions, but also political frictions? Thank you.
So there's no question?
Yeah, I'm asking if you actually see this need for an additional force to remove some of the state capitalism, or the authoritarian recently called capitalism in China, in order to give this collaboration a chance to really grow systemically internationally? And what would that force be?
Make comments on that? I think this is a huge question. I was engaged in a discussion with a P yesterday, and my think on this is, if you tell the Chinese leadership, say, get out of the way of the economy, that's mission impossible. I want to be frank to you, okay? I'm not speaking on behalf of the president or the premier, okay? But I know their heart, okay? If you say, don't put your hands into the economic and those kind of issues, the trade issues, that's mission impossible. Because the Communist Party's central tasks, if you read their documents, is to grow the economy. That's the whole party's job, okay? They talk about all kinds of reforms, everything for what? Economy, economy, economy. Now you say, move your hands away from economy. That's mission impossible. So I think if they say it's impossible, so should we stop working with them? The answer is no. We still need to work with them. How? I think we still need to adjust our own mentality. We seem to kind of develop a panic, and like a sense of those kind of sense. Oh, communism is a monster. We have that kind of sense in this country. Okay, communism is a, well, socialism is a monster too, right? Those two are monsters. We cannot touch them. We cannot talk to them. I would say, look, go to China. Take a look at what communism is. How it works. Are they human beings? They're not monsters. They don't have two, you know, four legs and four hands stuff. They're human beings. Okay, at a human being level, at the individual level, you can have a really friendly, cooperative discussion. Once that happens, you build trust. Now the problem between those two, be honest with you, I think from my judgment, China, US, Russia, Japan, in the long term, they will be competitors, for sure. Okay, for sure. They will be competitors. There will be competitions. The only question, we don't want to be enemies. We don't want China, US, and Japan become enemies. They fight against each other, right? And that's the worst scenario. They need to work with each other. So we need to make adjustment to ourselves. And then try to convince them, hey, there are better ways to do things. Don't just put everything to the state enterprises. And that's not too good to you. But if you just move your hands from the economy issue,
Audrey, I think there's some good news on the horizon. One of the things about this recent scandal with the Boshi Lai was a sense, and we just picked it up in Beijing, there's a lot of discussion on the street about that. One of the things that Boshi Lai represented was, in a sense, almost an anti-reform platform. That is, that the need to bring these reforms to the next level, it seemed that Bo was part of a group of people who said maybe the reforms have gone too far, and that maybe we need to actually step back from some of them. And there's been that discussion kind of eking through the policy level now over the last couple of years, in fact. And I think the fact that he was not only squashed, but really squashed so hard, really is a reflection of the fact that these reforms, in fact, are not going to stop. And that under Xi Jinping, I can't tell you by any degree how fast we will go, but I think that we're going to continue to move ahead. And I think that bodes very, very well. But we do know that there is one stopping point, one parameter, and that is the power of this present regime and present leadership of the Chinese Communist Party. That is a parameter that basically is not going to be easy to move off center. And I think that we can see much more political change without having to, you know, alter that position of the party. We can see much more economic change clearly. But I think that we've also got to recognize at the end of the day, there isn't a parameter, I think, that is not very movable. Now, whether or not the need to become an innovative economy will force that question even faster to the agenda and bring it to the top, I think that's starting to happen. But I think that at least over the next 4 or 5 years, we're not going to see that move and shift that much in that direction.
I would actually put a much more negative spin on the Boshi Lai situation. I think what it shows us, in fact, is that the situation is much, the system is much less institutionalized than we thought, much less rule-based than we thought, and the fact that both he managed to amass this power and they managed to take away this power in such a non-transparent way, you know, trials, you know, his Gukilai's trial taking a day, and who knows how long Boshi Lai's hearing is going to last. It suggests to me that, in fact, we're probably farther away than we were when we thought we were.
I think I can agree with both Simon and that, because I think there's a I think what Simon said is also right, which is that they went after Boshi Lai harder than many of us expected, and so that it's. But on the other hand, I don't think that signals a fundamental rethinking about the system. But at least some of the practices that he adopted are thought about more negatively, more critically than so it's not just a mere power struggle, right? So I think that level of signal is there. But I think I'm more optimistic about the political change in China. I think there are two forces driving the political change. One is the aspirational goal of achieving science and technology excellence. And Denis talked about this conference where they actually began to talk about those issues. But the bigger change is actually what's happening on the ground. And there are a number of things there. If they don't change the political system, the distributional conflicts are going to be so severe that you lose any political stability from fast economic growth, right? So the distributional conflicts are already very severe, and I actually challenge the view that growing GDP faster is a way to preserve political stability. It's exactly the opposite. Growing GDP faster in the way they do it exacerbates conflicts, exacerbates distributional issues. The other change, and this is kind of related to technology, is social media. It's really bringing about a huge change in the way that Chinese think about some of these political issues and institutional issues. previously, without the social media, there's a way for the top to communicate with the people on the street, and there's a way for the people on the street to communicate to the top. There's no horizontal communication, right? So social media changes that tremendously. If Twitter in this country is bringing about some changes, microblogging in China has brought about changes that are multiples of the changes in this country. Let me give you a personal example. I don't even go on to microblogging in China very often. This year I've written maybe 4 or 5 microblogs, and this is already October. And I have 900,000 followers. And I don't know why. It's an entirely different game, you know.
And buy them?
Did I buy? No, I don't have the kind of you overestimate the MIT's capacity to. and it's very interesting. I think of myself as a liberal, and the people who have more followers tend to be liberal intellectuals, rather than the conservative ones. So there is a social preference for change, right? In a way, I mean, the way I define Chinese conservative is defending the status quo. Liberals are advocating change, right? So there's definitely a preference there, because the contrast is so sharp between the liberal followers and the conservative followers.
Okay. We have to wrap up. I want to end though with a quick lightning round, one sentence. The year is 2049. Do we 2049? Do we have an Chinese innovation juggernaut, Yifei?
I hope so.
I think we'll have a Chinese Nobel Prize winner by then, at least.
We have a Nobel Prize
yesterday.
We had one already. Hey,
Adam.
Pockets of excellence.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Okay. Thank you very much. Can we give our gratitude then? Thanks.
Thank you.